Hello. I hope you're doing well. Welcome to Let's Talk. Ego. And this was a subject that was suggested by a particular viewer and hopefully she knows who she is. So Lynn, thank you. If you're still watching, for those of you new to this particular series or my channel, this is a chance just to talk about some deep subject matter. Because it's something I've always enjoyed thinking, philosophizing, analyzing. And I know there's a lot of folks out there who do the same as well. And while we can't really have a back and forth discussion, I wanted to kind of explore my thoughts and feelings on the subject, my own experiences, with the hopes of reaching some folks who might benefit from this knowledge sharing session, which it pretty much is. So in this video, we're going to talk about a few aspects of ego. I'm sure most of you, when you hear the word ego, think of egotism. Or being egotistical. That's probably the most familiar aspect of that word or variation. A self-inflated view of oneself. We think we're more important. It can lead us to being self-centered and things like that. But there's also some other definitions or meanings to ego, and that is egoism. It's the philosophy, somewhat, that one's self should be the goal or motivation behind everything we do, our actions. Somewhat interchangeable with egotism, but not necessarily. Because you can still think that your own interests are what drive you to do the things you do, and that can be totally separate than thinking that you're the smartest person in the world, that you're the most creative, that you're so very important. you know. And you can really go off into different forms of egoism as well. So we'll talk about those two, and then we're going to talk about someone who I have been very interested in as of late and for a while now, and that is Carl Jung's ego. And it's not necessarily his ego, but it's actually ego plays a role in his teachings and his philosophy, you could say, of psychology of our mind and how ego plays a part in our total, or the totality of our psyche. Now, before we get any deeper into this, I want to let you know that I'm not an expert on Carl Jung. I'm not an expert on anything. I'm a jack of all trades and a master of none. I know a little about a lot. I like to absorb. I'm like a sponge. I like to absorb as much as I can about this life. You know, digest it, chew on it, see what suits me and my philosophy, try to grow from the knowledge that I gain, and then try to share it with others and, you know, things like that. So why don't we get started with the most common, I would think, the most common type of ego, or what most people think of when they hear the word ego, and which I think kind of relates to Carl Jung and his teachings, his philosophy, however you want to think about it, or say his psychology. And that's, we're going to talk about the ego as it relates to egotism. Okay? And this is something. And this is exactly what the viewer had in mind that suggested this. And something that I've battled with all my life, still battle with, and I'm sure a lot of folks out there may as well. And that is egotism, that is being egotistical. And specifically she mentioned, if I could talk about how we can be too proud in regards to saying we're sorry, you know, being forgiving, things like that. And I think there's a couple reasons as to, or a few reasons as to why we might be too proud to say we're sorry. You know, and it kind of relates to Carl Jung's and possibly Sigmund Freud's teachings of ego. And that is, we have a perception that we portray to others. And saying we're sorry, admitting we're at fault, can take courage to admit a mistake and to be, because we know there's a lot of shame involved. Embarrassment can be humiliating. Admitting no one likes to admit they're wrong, right? But I think it's a sign of being brave and being true and being honest, to set aside your ego and not to think about yourself, and then to say, you know what, you're right, I'm sorry, you know, I didn't mean to do such and such, or you know, what have you. And our egos can get in the way of healthy relationships that we might otherwise have. Because you could have people, a lot of us butt heads. We don't want to admit we're wrong. We think we're right, especially when it comes to personal beliefs, philosophies, mindsets, interests. And it takes an open mind, it takes a lot of courage, again, to be receptive to someone else, and again, to not think of yourself, and to let your ego go, and you know, walk over into the other person's yard, into their house, knock on their door and say, you know, I'm sorry. Or even just to accept what they have to say, or accept who they are, things like that. But, you know, being proud, being vain, those are signs of being egotistical. You know, it's kind of like doing YouTube videos. This is something that I've battled with all my life, is my ego. I don't like, I'm sure some of you can relate, probably don't like people who shove themselves, force themselves onto us with their money or their fancy cars, you know, things like that. Or how smart they are. No one likes a bragger, no one likes a show off, right? And that was one of the things I struggled with, and I still do sometimes with my channel, you know. For instance, if I purchase a mask and you know, I wanted to show it off and do an unboxing video of it, but I realized that's kind of like being egotistical. That's why I don't like to do unboxing videos on my channel too much. No offense to anyone else, but that's just my own personal thing. I don't like to show off, look at me, look what I got, look at my toy, you know, so to speak. Because I know I can empathize with someone that cannot afford these things, what have you. I don't own a watch, a gold watch. I don't drive a fancy car. I drive a Civic. I have a car payment. We're pretty much middle class working people. And, you know, I have one pair of jeans to my name. You know, I'm a very simple kind of guy. But I like to put my money into the things that I do creatively. You know, this is, I know I'm getting off on a little bit of a tangent here, but this is my this, you know, and all of these masks and these props and things are my paints, if you will. But, you know, I think it's important to keep a balance in life, to not be too happy, not to be too down, you know, not to, because when you're too happy, you're too positive, you know, it kind of sounds kind of strange, but you can not only be naive to some things, but it's just not, it's kind of unrealistic to just always go around happy, and you can sometimes be annoyingly happy, you know. Hey, how you doing, Bob? Oh, that's great. Oh, I'm sorry you're feeling down. Well, feel better. You know, no one likes that, you know. And, you know, you don't want to always walk around like a grump either, you know. You know, so, and that's hard. It's especially when you're depressed and you have that illness. Something I've dealt with too. But so you want to keep a balance in all aspects of your life, mentally, physically, with the types of food that you eat, with your emotions. And the same thing with your ego. You don't want to be too one way and you know, too full of yourself, so to speak, too proud. And you don't want to be too humble either. You know, you want to be right in the middle, keeping yourself in check. And what is at the core of being egotistical? Why do some people feel a need to be? Why are some people full of themselves? Why do people brag? You know, there's so much war and fighting and arguments in real life and on the internet because of ego. And I think, again, it has to relate to Carl Jung. And I relate a lot to Carl Jung, not that I'm saying I'm on his same level mentally or knowledge experience wise, but I just mean some of the things that he's talked about. He's a very common sense, down to earth approach and view, artistic and things like that. But I think the core of being egotistical and being full of yourself is a very basic, primal thing. And there goes my broken piece of chalk that we all experience in one way or another. And that is the F word. Fear. I think that there are a lot of reasons that we do the things that we do is that we're afraid. When we call someone names, when we demean someone, when we're being mean, there's something about that person that we are, that brings out something in us, in our shadow, in our unconscious, that Carl Jung writes about, teaches about, that we have yet to face. Something that we don't like. Carl Jung says that we will meet ourselves in 1,000 different faces throughout our lifetime. Basically saying there are parts of ourselves in our unconscious, hidden deep, that we're not aware of, that we have yet to face, that we try to avoid, that we will encounter in other people. And that's the truth. I can really speak to that. But I think it's fear. Why do we feel the need to show off? Out of fear, out of trying to compensate. You know, we're compensating for something. But that's fear to me at a core, at a very base level. We have fear of not being as good or as worthy or not having the attention of others and things like that, you know? I think fear drives so many is a driving factor of so many things that we say and do and think. Case in point is what the viewer suggested. Why are we sometimes too proud to say we're sorry? Fear. Fear of being wrong. Fear of, again, humility, of fear of losing a friend. I mean, there's so many examples of that in regards to being too proud and the reasons behind not wanting to say you're sorry or I mean, there's so many different aspects here. There's things in this video that I'm probably going to miss. So I might do a follow-up someday, but you know, for now it's fear, you know. We're afraid. And I think that's a driving factor behind a lot of things. And you know, I think, you know, in the grand scheme of things, does it really matter whether we are humble or egotistical? No. In the grand scheme of things, nothing we do, think, or believe in matters. This is my view, this is my opinion. You know, I love to get down into the weeds. I love to dig around and analyze and understand things. Then I like to take a step back and see the forest for the trees. And when you take a step back and see this planet and realize we're just another organism, you know, all this I'm saying, all the things that we teach and learn, how many billions of years from now is it going to be meaningless when, you know, the sun becomes, you know, dies out or whatever becomes a soup? I don't know. I'm not a scientist, astrologer, whatever, by any stretch of the imagination, but you know what I'm saying. You know, it doesn't really matter, you know, but in the grand scheme of things. But we are people, we have feelings, we interact with each other every day. We're on this planet, we live in this economic system. We deal with a lot of hardships, mentally, physically, and I think it is important in that regard in everyday life. You know, it's one, you know, we can be logical, cynical, and look at things in that kind of perspective. It doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of things. To each their own, we're all trying to survive. Okay, that's fine. But everyday life, you know, at the end of the day, we should get along and try to grow and improve so that instead of having a negative impact on someone and that trickle effect, because everything we do and whenever we react with someone, it's a constant chain of reactions. I say something to you, it's mean, you react back to me, your reaction could trickle to somebody else because maybe you don't want to say anything to me, so you take it out on somebody else, and that person, and it is a chain reaction. So, and we have a choice. I know I'm getting off tangent here a little bit, but we're going to circle back. But this is what I do. I'm on a stream in life, and you know, I get off onto the riverbed and explore a little bit, and then I get back in my boat and continue down the stream of consciousness, so to speak. But we have a choice. And we have a choice to have a positive impact on people's lives, and we have a choice to have a negative impact on people's lives. I know that sometimes you deal, or we as a whole, deal with things. And sometimes that really impact our decisions. You have a hardship, whether it's mental, physical, financial, whatever. That can really impact your choice on how you want to act and how you want to interact with others. And I understand that. But even then, you still can choose. Unless you have a real severe, something that's debilitating. But, you know, and sometimes you can choose not to go either way and just, you know, not interact. But, so, you know, we can go around being negative and having a negative impact on people's lives, whether it's trolling, whether it's cutting people off in traffic. I mean, there's so many different examples of being a negative person or a negative source of negativity. Or we can choose to be positive, to be kind, you know? It's cool to be kind. Being kind and being having a positive impact on people's lives is just a beautiful thing. And it just, again, it has a trickle effect as well. And it's kind of what Carl Jung teaches. Is that if we have a positive impact with one another, and we do things positively, and I don't mean patting each other on the back and being, hey, hello, I'm feeling great today. You know, I mean doing, helping one another, holding the door open, simple gestures like that, or financially helping someone, you know, things like this. That's, while in the grand scheme of things, to each their own, who cares about one another, blah, blah, blah. But in reality, you know, at the end of the day, we should try to have, we shouldn't be strapping bombs to ourselves and blowing up a bus of innocent people. And I don't really know if that still goes on, but we should be open-minded, understanding, respectful. Respect is a huge thing. And, you know, kind, courteous, forgiving, patient, tolerant, all those things. And that's the same when it comes to being egotistical. I have a choice almost every day, even when I come here to make videos. What kind of video do I want to make? How do I want to portray myself? And this kind of relates to Carl Jung, which we're going to get into. You know, how do I want to come across? How do I want to be perceived? How do I want to interact with others? You know? And it also has a lot to do with, some people are empaths and some are not. I'm of any more I'm of the belief that being empathetic is a trait. You know, we are a complete package as a human being, meaning that we have DNA that decides what we are going to be made up of physically, what we're going to look like, our bones, color of our eyes, you know, things like this, prone to heart disease or, you know, things like all kinds of things. Well, I'm pretty sure that goes the same for our mental and makeup of our psyches. And I'm pretty sure, you know, anymore, as I chew on a lot of things that I learn and read about, that being a highly sensitive person, that ASMR, that being empathetic are traits that you either have or you don't. Some people experience ASMR, some people don't. Just like some people have blue eyes and some have brown. Now when I say that, I'm not trying to be egotistical or act like these people are special. Everyone is special, just like Springbok ASMR. I'm not sure if any of you know about her. She's very creative, but also very smart. And she did a video discussing the pyramid of something. I have no idea. I forget now. She talks about how we're all special, and it's true. And but I'm not gonna go off on that, because that's what, you know. Leave it up to her. Leave it up to you to watch that video. Again, I'm going off topic a little bit, but let me get back on the boat. So you know, we all have good and bad qualities. Somebody who is empathetic, an HSP, and experiences ASMR has good qualities and bad. Everything in life has a pro and a con, light and dark, yin and yang, light and shadow. There's no doubt in my mind, you know. Left brain, right brain. I mean, it's pretty much a truth as far as I'm concerned. I'm just saying that's my, you know, my personal truth. And someone that doesn't experience ASMR, that's not an HSP, that's not empathetic, okay, so that's the con of their personality, but they also have a pro. They're very, they're like go-getters. They are like the, I'm trying to understand how a non-empath works when I'm an empath, or an HSP, a non-HSP, but there's pros and cons to all of us, but we're all special in our own ways. So that's, I'm trying to get off the riverbed into my boat now and go back down the stream. That's why I said it, I think it's important that we not only interact positively with others, but we also have a positive view of ourselves and keep ourselves centered, balanced, mentally, physically. Especially when it comes to ego and being egotistical. No one likes a braggart. No one likes to show off. And I'm not going to sit here and pretend or try to come off like I'm perfect. I'm not. I've done things, especially early on in my channel, in Facebook, things I haven't been proud of as far as how I've gone about expressing myself and interact with others. But that's because I've going through a lot, not an excuse, but 40 years of pent up creative frustration. And, you know, having been bullied, having dealing with anxiety, depression, being unsatisfied with previous jobs, where my life was headed, and all this stuff. Until I met my wife and had my son and all that. Everything's come together, kind of, in a very interesting, synchronic way, I guess. Synchronic way. But, so yeah, I've my ego has gotten the better of me, but anymore, over the last year at least, I would like to think, maybe a little bit more, I've tried to be more balanced, keep myself in check, you know, try to live a humble life, but not to the point where I'm too humble, too extreme, you know, so. But it can be hard if you're not an empath, if you're not empathetic, if you don't know what it is like to walk in, if you can't put yourself in other people's shoes, then it can be difficult to maintain your ego, I think. Because you sometimes, and I've been around people that I think are not empathetic, and that's not a fault. Again, I think it's a trait. And they say and do things not to intentionally hurt anyone or anything like that, but they just aren't aware of how what they say or do will come across as someone who is empathetic. So you have the non-empath communicating and acting a certain way, and the empath over here, like, whoa, you're just totally not being taking into consideration my feelings or other feelings, and it can be this this battle almost. It can be very polarizing. You know, it's like I said, both personalities have their pros and cons. So that's the main gist or discussion point about the ego that I wanted to talk about first, the one that we all familiar with usually when we hear that word, you know, being egotistical, full of ourselves, bragging. You know, no one likes that, really, I don't think. You know, it's funny, we don't like, and I'm sure a lot of you can agree, we don't like it when people are a certain way. Then when it comes to how we are, well, we can do what we want. Look at him, he's a show off, but then you have no problem showing off your new car to your friends, or, you know, taking a selfie on Facebook, you know, so, and that's cool, we're human. We are, a lot of us are hypocrites, not necessarily in a bad way. We are very, I don't want to say hypocritical, that's kind of extreme, but there's a little bit of truth there, and especially in this world, I mean, there's a lot of us have a lot of fear. Fear drives anxiety. Fear makes us try to compensate for things that we think we're lacking because we see others, you know, there's a lot of competition, a lot of primal things, and I'm going to get into that now. That Carl Jung talks about. I'm not going to talk too much about egoism as far as that our interest should be the driving factor behind our actions and words. It's a very kind of a philosophical thing to go on about, and it's very similar to egotism, but not. I mean, I could briefly talk about that, but I haven't really delved into that too much. So I'm just going to kind of, you know, gloss over that a little bit. And basically, all that is really is, without even really having studied it or anything, is that we are all individuals, you know. Are we monogamous creatures? Are we a community? Even though we're human race, do we all have to get along? Again, in the grand scheme of things, no. We don't. I'm going to die. You're going to die. We're all going to die. There's going to be more people coming after us. Plenty of people have come before us. You know, we're nothing special. Blah, blah, blah. You know, we could live that way. Well, who wants to live that way? Right? What's the fun in that? So you have that one aspect, maybe logically looking at things that way. Then you can look at things a little, I think they have more meaning. Now, of course, I'm HSP, so I'm always going to look at everything with meaning, and it includes life. So should my own interests drive everything that I do and how I act with others and things like that? I mean, I don't see a problem with that. We're all individuals. So I'm doing my own thing here on my channel. But it doesn't interfere with my family life. You know, if again, I think it's all about balance. I'm doing what I love the way I want to do it. But, you know, you and others hopefully benefit from it. I make sure that what I'm doing in my own personal interest doesn't interfere with my family, doesn't interfere with others. Maybe it interferes with my lifestyle, my health, because I stay up too late. Like when I made the medical exam of the undead, I got 2 hours of sleep that night. That's ego right there, and we're going to get into that. Yeah, I think you can have a healthy ego. You can have a healthy sense of yourself in the world and how you interact with others, as long as it doesn't go to the extreme. You know, as long as you aren't forcing your opinions, your beliefs, your lifestyle onto someone else. As long as you're not, as long as you're not also being too withdrawn and, too self-conscious or low self-esteem, or so you want to be yourself, you want to be out in the world, you want to, let people know who you are, and it's okay to be proud and to show the things that you own or your accomplishments. But again, you don't want to just constantly do that. You don't want to brag all the time. No one likes to brag. It's when you go to the extremes, And it's just like anything. Any kind of extreme isn't very healthy. So now we're going to talk. I think I pretty much covered everything there about egoism, and the main types, or what we often associate, at least I do, when I hear the word ego. You know, someone's full of themselves. Well, maybe there's a reason why. And then that's another ego aspect, being judgmental. Why do we care that someone is egotistical, or someone is overcompensating for something? You know, what does it matter how they live their lives? Well, it only matters to me how everyone else or how you live your life, as long as you're doing something good and helping others and things like that. Beyond that, how you live your life, if you're an egotist, too important, not really. But again, depends on, I guess the people that you're interacting with, things like that. So I talked quite a lot about And we're going to, egoism, egotism, we're going to move into more deeper stuff and talk about Carl Jung and his teachings, his view on ego. And how it relates to our psyche and our lives, and what ego is in regards to Carl Jung's teachings and its place. So, the ego, and I'm going to draw here a picture of exactly how the ego, where the ego, what it is, and how it plays a role in our psyche in regards to what Carl Jung taught. And then while this may not be relevant in what they teach today in psychiatry or psychology, I don't know. You know, any of you out there, feel free to chime in that are studying psychology. There's some folks that think Carl Jung is crazy. Okay. Think his teachings are irrelevant. Okay. But no one knows, no one's right and no one's wrong. There is no right or wrong. I mean, there is the trees, there is the sky, there is the sun, you know, the air, you know. Beyond that, everything is up for discussion. Because we don't have the answers. There's no handbook. There's no handbook to life, to being a human being. So it's just make it up as we go. And hopefully some will be right eventually. All right, so looks like I spilled a little water here. Let's just erase this a little bit more. So I'm going to draw here a little diagram. And if you pull up, do an image search of Carl Jung ego, you might find this diagram. It's a circle and it talks about ego, talks about self. And you're going to see what I think makes a lot of sense in regards to his teachings, his view, his philosophy, however you want to call it, of ego. Not the perfect diagram, I kind of messed it up a little bit, but this is what I do. There's nothing really planned too much. Besides what I want to talk about, and maybe some ideas. I don't really script anything, because I'm mostly lazy. But maybe that's a good thing. Right? Pros and cons. Up here a little bit, just to It's not the most perfect circle. I am a fan of a perfect circle anyway. So, here is ego. Here, and it is in this, I don't know how you want to call it, diagram of, I'm not sure if Carl Jung ever drew it this way, but this is one way of looking at his teachings, because he really talked about the unconscious. So we have the outer world, all the world around us. This is our psyche, right here, okay? The circle here is our psyche, the totality of our psyche. So we have our persona. This is the mask that we wear, and how we perceive, and how we show ourselves to the outer world, right here up top. So it's kind of like facing the outer world. This is the inner world. This is everything inside of us, in regards to, you know, what we think and everything that happens, and our conscious awareness, what we're not aware of, and everything like that, everything we've been taught. The persona, it's basically, you know, what I want to show you. Like on this video, how do I want you to perceive me as? That's my persona. I could have put on a fancy dress shirt tonight and all that, and I was going to, but I thought that was too egotistical, so I'm just wearing this old little kind of whatever, regular ratty long sleeve shirt thing. But that's persona, right? And here is ego. And the ego is the king, or maybe if you're a woman, you can think of it as the queen. But there was I'm not sure who, but there was this particular website described it this way. And it's the king oversees all the land. And the king basically is you ruling your consciousness, what you're aware of, and the king decides what the persona will be, what's acceptable, what you will or will not face in your own psyche, what you will accept, all of that. And that's the ego. It's not egotistical. It's not egoism, it's not an overflated sense of self, it's not being a braggart. It is the part of your persona, basically, and it's somewhat similar to Freud's ego, the id and the superego. The id is very primal, all the natural instincts. The superego is the moral high ground, and the ego is, I understand, keeps everything in check, very rational. But the ego is basically everything you've learned that you're aware of. It's your, and you can see right here, it's a lot of it's on a level of consciousness. Then we have personal unconsciousness, personal unconscious. Then we have collective unconscious down here in the shadow. But the ego, the persona, that's pretty much in your conscious mind, the things that you are consciously aware of, that you're awake. And the ego decides, almost is like a filter, and what you're going to believe in, what you'll accept. And perhaps egoism and egotism comes from there as well. If you're trying to compensate for something that you're lacking, some kind of maybe love or something that's hidden in your unconscious, your shadow that you haven't fully addressed or even understood or come to realize, then your ego could be, you could be compensating for that by being a braggart or being a show-off. And that's, that could come from the ego. The ego says, you know what, I'm going to show off my fancy car, blast my radio, because whatever, I'm not getting enough attention somewhere. But this ego, Jung's ego, is not egoism or egotism itself. I don't really know if Jung talks about pride and vanity, so I can't really speak to that, but that's what the ego is. It's more related to Freud's ego. Okay, then we have the self. The self is the totality of the psyche. It is both everything you are aware of, everything you've learned, all your experiences, your beliefs, philosophies, plus everything that you're unconsciously aware of that's deep, whether primal things, base human characteristics, emotions such as sex, whether it's sexual, whether it's fear, hunger, a lot of that stuff is very base down in the shadow and into the collective unconscious. Your personal unconscious. Okay, basically, what the unconscious is, from what I understand, and again, I'm not a Jungian expert. But the unconscious is basically all the information that we take in, the personal unconscious, all your experiences, because, and this is another aspect of ego. Ego is the king, it's like a judge. It's like a filter. Your eyes, your nose, your hands, all your senses take in so much stimuli all the time. It's impossible to be aware of all of it. You know how you can be listening to someone or something and then all of a sudden you can zone out and you're thinking of something else, you're in another world, and that's your ego. It's things like that. Your mind can only focus on so much. While you can still hear the person's voice and maybe kind of understand what they're saying, you can all of a sudden, if it's strong enough, get lost in that thought, that memory, or whatever. Kind of like your ego, what I talked about earlier in regards to that video that I did, or the videos that I often do when I lose sleep. That's ego, not egotism or egoism. That is this personal self-interest that's driving me, that has turned off sleep, that my body is now needs sleep, but my mind has flicked that switch because now it is feeding this urge to create, this ego that I need to edit this video and upload it, and get it done and move on to the next thing. That is somewhat, maybe borderline egotism, but it's not like the over-inflated sense of self, which is the reason that I'm up at 3 a.m. It's just my need that I need to create. I need to get this done, and that's ego. It has turned off my sleep. Or you can be doing something, and your body's hungry, but your ego now say no, you're going to focus on this task, And that's why you can be, sometimes we don't realize we're hungry until hours later. So that's the ego, you know, and kind of how that works. And the consciousness is the personal unconscious. So all this stimuli, or even our own base emotions like hunger, they're coming in, and we only can focus on certain things at a time. But everything goes into our personal unconscious. It is our own experiences, our own philosophies, the things that we've learned, and what we've thought about, and all of that, the interactions we've had with people. A lot of those things that we remember or consciously aware of, like your favorite types of music, your favorite whatever, your friends. But then there might be somebody that you met or went to school with, and you no longer remember their name. Maybe you barely remember their face. Well, that's in your personal unconscious, okay? And the ego, you know, decides, you somewhat decide if you want any of that, if you're ready to face any of that, if you've buried any of that personal unconscious, and to bring it into your daily life, your conscious, your persona, even your active, your awareness, your awake mind, I guess. Then you have the collective unconscious, and then you have the shadow. And the collective unconscious, Jung talks about, I think it makes total sense. It is a lot of the same things, traits, base human emotions that we all share. Fear, sexuality, of course, but other things as well that we all share as human beings. So you have your personal unconscious and all the things that you personally have learned, but then there is the collective unconscious and all the things that we've learned as a species. Not so much that you know how to make fire from when you're born, but all the things that over the millennia or whatever that makes up our that is common to many of us, such as anxiety. That I think anxiety being high empathy, things like that would be the collective unconscious. You don't learn to be an empath, if you ask me, or a highly sensitive person, or you don't learn to be afraid of spiders or get anxiety. You know, I think a lot of these things are common traits that a lot of us have and share, and there's more to it than that, but that's basically the gist of what the collective unconscious is. It's the shadow. It's and the shadow is, again, you know, it's yin and yang. It's polar opposites. We have everything that we have accepted in our ego that we want to be aware of, that we're ready to accept as a part of who we are, that we may or may not show in our persona to the world. If I am proud to be an open-minded person, then that's probably going to be portrayed in my persona and how I live my life. But if I'm a closed-minded person and I hate aliens from Mars, then there's something in my shadow that I have yet to face. And that's, the shadow is not just fear, it's not just primal based things like fear of spiders or or anxiety. But it can be also, and of course it's part of the collective unconscious, but it's also things that we have yet to just not accept and or address or face our demons. It's the classic Jekyll and Hyde. And it's a lot of us have this commonality among us. Again, I like to think a lot of these things are traits. Whether anxiety is a trait, or depression, or being a highly sensitive person, whatever it is, there's a lot of things that we have in common. And a lot of this stuff in our unconscious comes out in dreams, you know. But this video isn't so much about Jung's teachings of the psyche and things like that. I want to focus on ego. And I kind of want to explain the other aspect of ego and in regards to our psyche, and not just talk about being egocentric, being egotistical, being full of ourselves, that not only may there be reasons, you know, here in the shadow. If you're compensating for something, then there's something in your shadow, there's something in your unconscious, personal unconscious, that you're trying to make up for. And I'm just kind of thinking if there's anything I want to talk about. So, you know, the ego, Jung's ego, you know, it is about, it's that thing, that part of us that dictates in our active, awake mind right now what I want to project. Just like how I want to come across in this video right now. You know, how I want the mask that I wear in my videos is very Jungian. If you ask me, the mask I wear in front of the mask you wear in front of your parents, your friends, your siblings, your work. You know, it's the things, you know, the ego in Garcia Jung's works, the things that the king, and he sees all his land, or the queen, you know, rules his land, and he sees all the things that makes up his personality, all the things that he's taught, and all the things that he's learned. And he decides how that's going to be portrayed. And he decides what he'll accept. And then he knows that over there in the distance is this shadow. He hasn't maybe explored that territory yet. Or he's not yet ready to incorporate those things into his active, into his land, into his kingdom. And make them part of his active mind. Aware, conscious mind, the persona. And that's my kind of take on it. I haven't studied Jung at all. I have the Red Book, which I still continue to read a little bit. And I speak highly of Jung because he's a very smart person, but I don't hold him up on a pedestal. I don't hold up anybody on a pedestal. I don't worship anybody. I think idol worship is just very prohibitive of self-growth. You know, and I'm human and make mistakes just like I did now. Just like anybody else. I'm not trying to put on airs. I don't try to be anything, you know, I try to improve the way I talk and communicate, which making YouTube videos, I highly recommend for anyone out there. I mean, it's overcome a lot of anxieties. I've personally grown from being on YouTube and tremendously as far as anxiety is concerned and overcoming those things. But aside from all that, You know, we are an interesting species, no doubt. What goes on up here? Very complex. And there's so much to talk about in regards to the ego, not just egoism, vanity, and egotism, and the philosophy of egoism, which you can just go spend hours and hours researching that and looking into that. But there's also Carl Jung's teachings, there's Freud's teachings, and I don't know whoever else might be out there today talking about egoism or ego. But I hope to the viewer that suggested this topic, I hope I covered what you're hoping me to talk about. For those of you that watched this video, I hope I touched on as many things as possible on this stream of consciousness. And feel free to comment or send me a personal message. And we will maybe revisit this topic again in a year from now. But no, seriously, the ego, it's something that is very powerful. Dictates sometimes that we're not even aware of. And we have hunger that drives us. There's a meme that says, "I'm sorry for what I said when I was hungry." And that's true. How many of us say things out of turn because we're so hungry? We're impatient, we gotta eat. And that's a basic need, and it's a basic base emotion and desire. And when you don't feed that beast, you know, a lot of people get grumpy, and you know, that's again, that's part of keeping your life in balance, is your physical health, eating right, and fear. You know, we do things out of fear, out of that base primal thing that's just a part of our collective unconscious. We are all afraid of something. Everyone experiences fear. There is no one in this world that is not afraid of something. Even if it is something about themselves they have yet to face. It's like facing yourself in the mirror and looking at who you are. And if you're, a lot of us sometimes don't realize what we say or do or how we act or the things that we've done until we take a hard look at who we are and face our shadow. I think that pretty much covered it. I'm winding down here now to what's left anyway of the video and video space. Otherwise, I'd go on for another 2 hours. But thank you very much for watching. And I hope I covered a lot of things. I hope this was interesting. If you're using this just to fall asleep, that's fine too. Hopefully, this was a little thought-provoking in some positive ways. Maybe learn a little bit more about me, maybe learn a little bit about yourself. I invite you to visit the links in the description of this video to learn more about ego, egoism, egotism, Carl Jung, etc. Just, you know, try to, in regards to your ego, and one of the things is to try to continue to learn as much as you can, explore as much as you can about this life, about yourself, for your own personal growth, so that we can all grow, you know, and learn from one another and work towards living towards our, you know, fullest potential. So, you know, personal growth. That's what a lot of it is, what it's about. You know, keep growing. And thanks for watching.